Shanghai GDG is a very interesting developer community.
I'm glad somebody has asked this question.
This is where the magic happens.
This is primarily a question and answer show. So if any of you out there would like to ask questions.
Hello, welcome to Payments Live. We have another very exciting session today. We'll be talking about one of the fastest growing segments in online payments, that is digital goods and services. And our special guest today is Google Wallet product manager Arundhati Singh. Arundhati, thanks for finding the time to join us.
Oh, absolutely. Very happy to be here. Thanks, Mihai.
Thank you. Glad to have you. And so let's get started. Arundhati, what is Google Wallet for digital goods?
Google Wallet for Digital Goods is a great new service that we have to monetize your online content and services. So if you take a look at the slide that I've just put up, what it is an in-context flow that we support both on desktop and mobile web. And some of the key benefits of using this flow are that it keeps customers on your site while they're completing their purchase. So it increases conversion, and it's a very simple integration for integrators. From a consumer perspective, it provides convenience as well as the security of the Google Wallet brand to complete their payments. And the last key point of one of the great things that we are very proud of that we've been able to do for integrators is provide really developer-friendly pricing. So it's 5% for microtransactions or 1.9 plus 30% US dollars for larger transactions, and the lowest price is automatically applied.
Great. Can you give us some example who are the users of this API?
Absolutely. So we've been fortunate to partner with some great developers, and up on the slide you'll see just a few of the great developers we've been working with over the past year plus. Zynga, Kabam, Graphically, Playdom, Rovio.
Wow, looks like all big names.
Absolutely.
And are we also using this at Google?
Yes, we absolutely are. So the other key point about Google Wallet for Digital Goods is that in addition to powering a number of great external developers, Google Wallet is the way to pay across Google. So for any user who's completing a transaction on Google Play, Google Offers, Google Plus, Google Voice, they're all paying with stored credentials from Google Wallet. And the great part about that is that's really enabled us to scale up our wallet user base tremendously, which is obviously an advantage to developers looking to integrate, because it makes sure that a greater percentage of your user base will be able to get a single-click purchase experience.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like an easy-to-use and easy-to-implement API. Can we have an example? Can we see a demo how it works?
Absolutely. So one of the integrators I'd mentioned on the previous slide was Graphically. They do digital content distributions. Comics books are just one example of what they sell. So if I am now logged into Graphically with my Google account, if I choose to purchase The Walking Dead, I am able to do so very quickly from their page. Here's the Buy Now button. By clicking that, it will now invoke the Google Wallet for Digital Goods API, which should be loading. As you can see, the purchase screen loads up right over the content, so there's no redirect away. And you can also see that because, again, as a user who also purchases from Google Play or Offers, my stored credentials are available right here, both cards
so
that
you
I use.
So can choose whatever card.
So I can choose very quickly and then very quickly complete a purchase with just a single click.
Very nice. It's nice that we glass over the window and you can still see what you're purchasing.
Right.
And it's good for the website that the user does not actually leave the site. Taking to another.
It's much
payment.
Less jarring for them,
yes.
And we do see improved conversion from that. So, one thing I'll point out just before I talk a little bit more about how this has performed for Graphically is that this confirmation screen is optional for integrators, so it's up to them whether they'd like to show it as an additional confirmation, or you can turn it off, and then it is literally just one screen. But to your point of the fact that it's in context, Graphically has seen overall a 5% increase in conversion from implementing this flow, and also a 10 to 22% increase in revenue per item, depending on the item, partially due to the friendliness of the pricing
screen. That's very nice.
So
besides Graphically, and we've seen a lot of big names on the previous slide, big game companies,
right.
Are there other use cases For this API?
Absolutely. One of the things we tend to see with digital content as games is often early integrators, but there are a wide variety of use cases that can be served with this type of integration. So online services, anything from something like TaskRabbit to Match.com that you can pay for online, online apps and software, games, as I've already mentioned, paid content, so music, videos, articles that you pay for, event tickets, and nonprofits are all segments that we're starting to work with more broadly and are very excited about.
I see this slide, it's covering basically the entire spectrum of digital goods and services. What is the average transaction size? Do we have any numbers around that?
So that's actually one of the great and very interesting things as we look at who's integrating and what our user base is. Given the very flexible pricing structure, we have integrators whose typical transaction price is 99 cents, all the way up to integrators whose typical transaction is hundreds of dollars. And again, it tends to vary a little bit by industry. So when you're talking about apps or online services, you see higher ticket prices versus games. But the pricing structure, as well as the overall architecture, support both.
Cool. One of the questions that we hear a lot is, when will Google Wallet for Digital Goods be available in my country? Can you speak about internationalization at all and where it's currently available?
Absolutely. So to start with, it's something that is a priority for us. Since launching, we've opened up support to over 18 seller countries. Now, one thing to point out is that, in general, all of Google Wallet products are available online to buyers in 140 countries, but you can set up as a seller. We support 18 countries and 9 currencies. The process to get additional countries added involves making sure that we can support that all throughout our stack. It's something we continually work to do, and we are looking to add additional countries in the next couple months.
Very nice slide. I like the summary here with the nice infographic with the
with all the flags.
With all the flags,
absolutely.
Yes.
So is that, well, I don't know if you can get into any more detail about that. Like, a lot of developers are always asking, oh, why isn't this available in Poland, or why isn't this available in the Czech Republic or those countries? I mean, I'm guessing there's a lot of procedurals and like regulations that we have to comply to before it can
So we need
there.
To, yes, absolutely. And as I mentioned, it is a very top priority for us to work through each of those so that we can bring this support to more and more developers. We are looking at launching 4 additional countries in the next month or two. So stay tuned for more details. That's about as much as I can say today about that. But you are right. We do have to evaluate on a country-by-country basis what is the licensing and the regulatory position and make sure that we're appropriately set up.
Okay. So let's get into one of the new features, subscriptions. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Absolutely. So we're very excited about subscriptions. We announced them at I/O, and they are live in production now. We have support for monthly billing, and in addition to that, you can support free trials or prorated first month. One of the things I wanted to mention is, while we announced subscriptions for external developers at Google I/O, this is the same subscriptions platform that powers subscriptions at Google, whether you're buying a subscription through Google Play or YouTube for premium content, or even Google Storage, as I've illustrated here, Google Drive Storage. So in addition to being able to support monthly billing and these particular use cases, integrators who integrate with us will then be able to have buyers manage their subscriptions via the Google subscription management UIs. Okay. We also provide merchant tools for that. And just one area of subscriptions that I did want to call out is we do have support for Dunning management.
What is Dunning?
So it's a subscriptions-related term, but what it really means is that when you've created a relationship with your customer and they've agreed that they want your services on an ongoing basis, but something goes wrong, their credit card gets declined in a few months, we help you manage that process so you don't lose that subscriber. So the way that works in this launch is that there is a grace period. Mm-hmm. We notify the subscriber. We provide them a way for them to update their payment information in our UIs, and that'll apply to all future subscription periods.
Got it. Cool.
Very exciting.
Absolutely. Yep. We're very excited about subscriptions.
And where do you see the future of Google Wallet for Digital Goods going?
So, as always, it's hard to speak to specific roadmaps, but there are a few things that are on my mind, that are on our mind overall as a product that we can talk to you about today. And I've listed just a few of them here on the slide. So, user challenges is one, for risk-based reasons. Basically, the ability to say, re-enter your password to complete this purchase, or provide the last 4 digits of your credit card. We are also, as mentioned earlier, looking at supporting additional merchant countries in the very near future. As mentioned, subscriptions is something that we've launched very recently at Google I/O. And we'd like to continue to extend and enhance that offering. And one of the things that I can say about that is we absolutely are looking at providing support for additional subscription billing periods. A couple other tools to make, so that's more in the core product and in the buyer experience. We're also looking at how can we make it easier for merchants and developers to then manage their day-to-day business. So we will be rolling out a brand new merchant center with improved UI and enhanced functionality, including support for better subscription management and also analytics to help you better realize how your business is performing.
So you were talking about user challenges before.
Absolutely.
And then I'm just thinking about it. I don't quite understand how that would simplify the flow,
right?
Like what the benefit of is.
I'm glad you asked that question because it's an important one to understand. The reason that user challenges are an important part of the experience is that they enable us to complete a higher percentage of transactions that might otherwise be flagged as risk or friendly fraud. This is an issue we see with digital goods. Now, a lot of things we've done have enabled us to streamline the purchase flow, enabling you to have a longer session so that users aren't constantly prompted for login before completing the purchase.
Mm-hmm.
But a key component of that is that to make sure that it's not someone from your family making an unauthorized purchase on your behalf or that your account hasn't been taken over, these challenges are a really low friction way to make sure that we can continue to enable that more seamless experience in the very broad majority of cases.
Got it. So we're trying to reduce the friendly fraud and like...
We're trying to reduce friendly fraud and again, make sure that a higher percentage of a merchant's transactions go through as opposed to being flagged by risk and failing.
Protect both the merchant
and the consumer.
And the consumer.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Cool. And I think that's pretty much all the questions that we have to interrogate you with.
I love talking about this product, super excited about it, and you know, happy to answer any questions that developers or prospective developers may have about it.
Yeah, let's look at the online questions.
If somebody wanted to integrate this, where would they go for information or resources?
Sure.
What's the URL?
So if you go to wallet.google.com, you'll find information about all of our online products. Mm-hmm. And this particular product, as mentioned, is Google Wallet for Digital Goods.
Got it. Perfect.
Thank you. All right, time for online submitted questions. I'm looking at our moderator page right now. And of course, we have a question about launching in more countries and currencies. And the country mentioned is Poland, which we actually also picked as an example. Yes.
So, I will say that we know that there's a very active developer base in Poland, and it is very close to the top of the priority list. And so hopefully you'll hear something exciting in the next month or two.
Good.
Next one. So Stephen from New York asks, can I use the digital goods wallet API to support my blog?
You absolutely can use this API to support a blog. Just like you would do for a normal e-commerce integration, you can sign up for a merchant account, again, at wallet.google.com. Once you've signed up for a merchant account, you are absolutely free to use this API to integrate with your blog and ask for support.
Are there any caveats with like support versus donation versus contribution?
So it's a great thing to clarify. In some of our additional products, we do make a distinction between donations and political contributions. So we provide donate buttons, but to use those, you have to be a registered 501(c) nonprofit. And similarly with our contribute buttons, you have to be a registered federal political candidate or political action committee. But to be able to just use this API and to be set up as a merchant, you can use that for a support use case. You just won't be entitled to use the donate or contribute buttons.
Got it.
Let's move on to the next question. This one is from James, who's testing subscription in the sandbox.
Mm-hmm.
And he wants to know, as the user places the order, how can he cancel the subscription right away? He's trying to test the entire API.
So users are actually able to cancel subscriptions by going into their personal wallet accounts online. So if I've made a purchase on your site or if I've made a purchase on Google Play, I can then log into my account at wallet.google.com and I'll see all of my subscriptions listed there. There's a subscription specific view and I can cancel from there.
And you can click and cancel.
I can click and cancel.
Okay. And then I per the API, then James will get a callback.
And yes, he will
from his perspective, he wants to know when that happens how he can test it.
So the minute that a user cancels, we do fire off a callback to the postback to the merchant, mm-hmm. informing them so that they can update their subscriber database and make sure to update that particular user's account on their site.
Cool. I think we have one more. You want to take it?
We do? I have not seen it. Oh, maybe reload.
Okay, just
why don't you take this one?
Okay, people are submitting it live, so yes. So we have a question coming from Canada. How will Google Wallet stay competitive with ISIS in US and worldwide?
Okay, so this particular product is actually aimed at the digital goods market, Google Wallet for digital goods. So again, online services, online apps and software, tickets and events, games. So it's not directly competitive to ISIS or Square.
Okay.
And if I guess if the question is related to the physical wallet, the tap and pay wallet, then none of us are subject experts, and we will bring on somebody from Wallet again to answer that later on.
And I believe there was a recent session done with Robin Dua that's probably available online to go back and look at.
Yeah. So check. You can probably check out last week's wallet session. We cover something similar to that. Mm-hmm. We're talking about ISIS and MCX and other initiatives as well.
But just to be clear again, for this product, it's not directly competitive to either. And we are seeing very good traction in the market with it, which we're excited about.
Cool. Looks like we keep receiving questions live as we speak. let me look at the next one. So the next one has to do with subscription periods, and in particular it looks like 3 months and 6 months are quite popular.
Right. So as mentioned, right now we support monthly billing, but we are absolutely looking for feedback from our developers of what additional periods are most important, because this is something we'd like to continue to enhance. So please do send that feedback through our developer relations team or on our forums, whether weekly, bi-weekly, quarterly, 6 months, or annual, what are your priorities? And we can look to incorporate that.
Are you doing anything like merchant-initiated recurrences? So I would say I want to bill something like 12 times in a year, mm-hmm. but then I can bill at any period or at any rate, as long as I submit like an API request.
So at this point, we will do the initiation of the charges on behalf of the merchant, and it will be based on an ongoing subscription schedule that's established upfront with the user.
Got it. But, okay, cool.
But again, that's what we're really looking for in terms of feedback from developers via our forums. What are the use cases you'd like to see us enhance so we can help prioritize?
Sounds good.
Keep getting more questions about international availability. But I think we answered that one to that.
Absolutely.
More countries are coming.
It's absolutely a priority for us.
All right. So I think this is it. I'm getting closer to our allocated time. So thanks everyone for watching again, and thanks Arundhati for stopping by.
Thank you. Very happy to be here.
And we'll see you next time. Bye.
Take care.
See ya.